The older you get, the faster time flies. In grade school, classes seem to last for hours. And in junior high, the days are long and slow. The tempo picks up in high school with sports and driving and dating. But it's not until the first year of college that the pace of life hits its frenzied peak. It's in that freshman year that a boy starts to become a man. Every student and every campus is different. Yet they're enough alike so that what happens to one freshman at one university can show some of what's happening on today's campus, can provide an important look during a time when the public's view of the university is often as confused as the first impressions of a new freshman. This is the story of student Richard Bain Smith, a Regent Scholar from San Diego, but it's also the story of every college freshman. It was filmed at the University of California, Riverside, where communication between students, faculty, and administration are uncommonly good. But it's also the story of changes taking place at every college. It's a study of the pressures that affect the university and how it responds to them. It's about the relationship between faculty and students, the use of beer and barbiturates, the loneliness, the search for a new pattern of life. This is a story of change, change on campus, change in the individual. It's a look at a demanding full-time job, the occupation of student.
Well, the first day I got here, you were supposed to come about 3. I got here about 11 o'clock in the morning. And I walked around, just all around the campus. I'd never been here before. So I just took myself on a complete tour, you know, and so I really, you know, I was really looking around and, you know, exploring, seeing what was around.
The first few weeks are lonely and hard, and maybe that's good, because there's plenty to learn. Who hands out meal tickets, what the professors want, how to find your way in the bookstore.
You come to this place, and you realize, well, I don't know anybody. There was one girl from my high school who goes here, and I didn't even know her. You don't feel at ease, really. You know, I would go out because I didn't feel like sitting around a room doing nothing.
At UC Riverside, Richard finds himself with some of the brightest students in the state. Only the top 12% of California's high school graduates are even eligible to apply for admission, and the teachers expect them to perform.
By the more formal uncle term. Okay, husband and wife terms fall into 3 main categories. First, they may be kinship terms. Wife, husband.
Boy, math is a lot tougher than it was in high school, so there's a lot more studying for that. You don't go home and do your homework in maybe 5-10 minutes anymore. When you have an integration problem, you work and you work and you work.
If classwork was the only pressure on them, students like Richard would breeze through college like fire through an old Christmas tree. But that's not the way it is. Away from home, often for the first time. Freshmen have to make decisions about classes and actions that may affect their entire lives.
There's just nobody that's going to tell you how to live your life anymore. And you know, you depend on yourself a lot more. You learn a lot you wouldn't learn any other way. And here's the whole thing about drugs and liquor and all that. You just learn to make your own decisions. I think that's the whole thing about college. Everything kind of relates to that. I know where I want to go. Like, I want to be a business administration major, definitely. I hope to go to law school and minor in computer sciences.
That's what he wants now, when he's not thinking about boosting grades or playing football. As he learns the ropes, Richard has time to do more things.
That was Cream with Sitting on Top of the World, and this is KUCR 88.1 on your FM dial. Next, we're going to hear from Led Zeppelin, a new group. My roommate picked up the record, and I really have liked what they put out. And here's one of their songs now, Rock Me Baby.
UC Riverside is not a party school. It has a high scholastic rating, and over half of its graduates plan to go on toward advanced degrees. Its students win a bigger share of fellowships, such as the Woodrow Wilson Foundation Awards, than many other schools of its size. But 6,000 healthy men and women don't live just for their studies. These students are aware of what's happening in the world, and they want to be a part of it. This is Donna St. Amand, one of Richard's friends.
When I came here, I was really scared to try anything that people would look down on me for, or, you know, that people would, you know, just crack my image, any image that I had when I first came here. Now, I don't really care, you know. I want to experience a lot of different things and, I don't know, just do everything different. And then I'm finding out what I like in life, you know, and exactly, I don't really care. People don't matter that much, you know. Sure, I want them to like me and everything, but it doesn't matter anymore so much what they feel, because I feel that everything's going to be changing eventually.
Mm-hmm. You want to get married?
I want to get married. I don't know. I thought I wanted a career when I first came here.
Were you going to be a lab technician? Was that Carolee?
That was Carolee. At first I was going to be a doctor.
You?
Mm-hmm. Then I was going to be a math major. Yeah. I was a doctor until I started filling out the applications, and it was a lot easier to put down math.
Freshman year is a time to experiment, to see how far you can go. Richard's experience with adult activities was pretty limited when he was home. And now that he's on his own, he's beginning to learn, sometimes the hard way, that too much partying can mean grief the next day. And no matter how you feel, when morning comes and there's work to be done, you've got to get up. Richard is doing well in a computer course this quarter. The computer has become such an important part of civilization that the graduate who doesn't know how it works and what it can do will soon be as out of date as an engineer without a slide rule. Students here use an advanced IBM computer. They write and punch cards for their own programs. And if they've asked the right question in just the right way, they sometimes get useful answers from the machine. Richard's success with the computer doesn't help in calculus. He's still having trouble. At some campuses, that could mean real trouble. Too often, professors concentrate on research and publications and don't have time left for students. But at UC Riverside, The major emphasis has been on teaching.
Label that number one, and it is a washer, so it has a...
Moreover, the publish or perish rule hasn't completely taken over, and professors still schedule time to work with students individually. After Richard pulled a D in one math quiz and flunked another, he asked for help from Professor Frederick Metcalf.
Now, the volume would be what, in terms of the various dimensions?
It would be this outer part minus the inner part.
Okay, fine. We're going to have the volume of the entire disc minus the volume.
That conference cleared up some key points and helped Richard recover enough to pass the course with a C. Guiding the progress of a major university isn't easy, especially not today. It requires constant communication with faculty and students, and an ability to recognize the main objectives even when the methods are changing.
As we were saying last night, we as a nation are running a very high temperature. We are ill. I'd rather say ill than sick. There is something, we don't know exactly what it is, and this very high temperature is breaking out in rashes here and there, and most of these rashes are university campuses, because it is on a university campus where the young and the older ideas come together, that the question become really focused and become very, very important.
Chancellor Ivan Hinderaker, Norman Better, and Carlo Galino discuss their basic philosophy over coffee.
That's fine, but what for?
And when you say create a university, what we really mean is that we want to create a university community. You know, just a university, just classes, just faculty, just students, this isn't enough. There's got to be some kind of cement, a bond of mutual respect among back and forth among all the people in it, a bond of respect for the institution, and an interaction among all these people, and out of that can come what I think is a truly great university community. This is what we're
the Chancellor's about. Commitment to the idea of community doesn't go unnoticed. Students know what is going on.
And we have a sensible Chancellor. I mean, he's the only Chancellor. You know, if he'll make a stupid statement, and you go in and you say, you know, you can call up and get an appointment with him for the next day, and you go and you say, Chancellor Hinderaker, something's the matter with this, you know. And he'll say, yeah, that's not what I meant. And then he'll say that's not what he meant to the campus, you know.
No one gets athletic scholarships at UC Riverside, so its teams will probably never make the big time. But it hosts the National Invitational Baseball Championships every year, and it does have a pretty fair swim squad. The sports that really attract support at Riverside, though, are the ones in which a majority of students can participate. UC Riverside is an hour's drive from Newport Beach, an hour from the Los Angeles Music Center, about 50 minutes from Palm Springs, and not far from fairly good skiing in the San Bernardino Mountains. In his first year here, Richard wants to try it all, which he won't be able to do. And he won't make the national ski team either. But at least he keeps trying. Riverside has no Sunset Strip or North Beach. So most of the entertainment takes place right on campus. Some of it's drawn high praise from critics, such as this modern dance sequence. Several of the drama group's offerings have also been very well received.
Oh, where are you going? Are you going out? To find the YW? Well, I'll come too.
What?
I'll come as well.
Where?
To find it.
What?
The YW.
Richard even tries esoteric medieval music. He's polite, but he prefers the sounds of his own time. These students are practicing for a performance they'll give Saturday night at the campus coffee house. It's called The Barn. The exciting thing about a university is that there's always so much going on. Everyone is concerned with his own things, and yet somehow, most are seeking similar goals. Knowledge, the ability to think clearly and critically, and a workable, developing philosophy of life. A good university doesn't just confirm conventional knowledge. It opens up minds to new and better ideas. So it should be expected that bright students, questioning established old theories in math and science, we'll ask some penetrating questions about society, too. There's been loudly voiced student dissatisfaction about some courses and policies, but since the campus is committed to change, the arguments have been more about how to accomplish goals than over what those goals should be. At Riverside, there is a tradition of loudly airing opinions on every side of every issue.
They kept espousing a very strong left-wing position, and they were never censored.
This is Philip Luce, an outspoken conservative. Invited speakers at the regular Wednesday noon convocations are selected by a joint student-faculty committee. At Charter Day ceremonies, the main speaker is Mark Hatfield, former governor and now senator from Oregon.
And massive appropriations than any previous time in history. Yet, polarization, unrest, and turmoil have not been abated, but rather have grown far more severe.
Senator Hatfield was also awarded an honorary degree for his contributions to public life. The opinions of the speakers ranged all the way from the conservative Luce through Hatfield to Charles Evers to Timothy Leary, the pioneer popularizer of LSD and other so-called mind-expanding drugs.
There are still a lot of people around who are feeling uptight. I submit to you that the hedonic gap is the only conflict in human life.
The over 30 generation gets worried when a compelling speaker such as Timothy Leary proposes potentially disastrous actions to bearded blue jean garb students. But these college men and women don't swallow everything they hear.
And leads to genetic mutations.
So he answered it to my satisfaction.
No, he turned it around and played word games with it, the guy that answered him. I mean, he turned it, the question around so that everybody laughed. And he never really answered the question. But you can screw up your life.
Well.
There's a bull session in Richard's room.
What violence really is you live in a ghetto and you see what real violence is. I mean,
I don't think
point where it would be survival.
I don't think any of us have the understanding of violence the way they...
The questions of black power and violence are also important to students at this campus.
Like, a lot of guys have never been in the ghetto. And they don't know what violence, real brute violence is.
UC Riverside has been recruiting black and Mexican-American students for several years and providing assistance wherever necessary. The aim is to help make the number of blacks and Chicanos in the student body more representative of the general population. An active black students union here persuaded the administration to help publish a black literary magazine. Black students were elected homecoming queen and student body president. but they are far from satisfied. This is the executive board of BSU.
What we're asking for now is a Black Studies Department. We feel that a Black Studies Department is needed by Black people and white people for a better understanding of Black people's problems.
Their views on this point are not completely shared by the faculty and administration.
I think there are some very unsound ways to develop ethnic studies, and I think there are sound ways. And I think here we're very fortunate, at least to date, in having an opportunity to pursue what we might think are the sound ways to achieve a very necessary and desirable result.
Most Black people, specific Black people, are going on notions that have been handed down to them by white people who didn't really understand what they were studying about or looking at.
In the end, the faculty and administration consolidated existing courses, added some important new ones, and created both the Black Studies Department and a Mexican-American Studies program.
I think that we should have been at this a long time ago. I think that every campus where this has not blown up is living on borrowed time.
What's important is not so much that a new department was created, but that the decision was reached through open discussion between the students, faculty, and the administration. One way to ensure that the school responds to the needs of all the students is to appoint members of all groups to responsible jobs. Arthur Martinez, for example, is in charge of special programs. Booker Williams is director of financial aids. Now, Richard doesn't care whether the financial aids officer is black or white. He wants to know whether he'll get a short-term loan or not. And he's worried about how he'll fare in the difficult courses of the last quarter of the freshman year. There are other things to consider besides flasks and forensics and formaldehyde. It's springtime. But this spring, there is tragedy, too. At the university's Berkeley campus, 400 miles away, violence erupts. Innocent people are hurt. The shock waves reach all campuses of the University of California, and the mood at Riverside suddenly turns as dangerous as a wounded tiger in tall grass. Terribly concerned by the events at Berkeley and the threat to what had been a reasoned dialogue at Riverside, Chancellor Hinderaker cancels all classes and shows up at a convocation for the entire campus. The crowd is bigger than for any other event in the school's history, and it is a worried crowd. A Berkeley faculty member blames most of the violence on overzealous authorities. The mood grows tense as the chancellor announces that the campus flag is to be flown at half-mast for the balance of the spring quarter.
It makes no difference whether it comes from students or police, or from the political left or the right. It should stop. The flag is at half mast to mourn the damage which has been done to our university by violence and the threats of violence. It's at half mast to shock each one of us into the knowledge that if violence continues, our university and this campus will be destroyed. The flag is at half mast to invite each of us who does not want to see the university and the campus destroyed to consider the individual responsibility for an environment in which education is possible.
Following a long, heated discussion, a majority of the student body votes to call a two-day voluntary strike of classes. But there is no violence. For Richard, with his conservative background and political inexperience, it's also a time for decision, personal decision. Spring is a cruel time at college. The smell of new mown grass and the warm breezes are relaxing. Flowers are blooming, and there's an overpowering desire to do nothing. Yet it's in springtime that the whole year rushes to conclusion. Richard is still troubled about his grades, his girlfriend, his draft status, and and his plans for next year. He now thinks he'd like to attend theological seminary when he graduates, but that notion probably won't last long either. And the fact that he's still undecided is healthy. For the purpose of the university is to arouse interest and help put new ideas into play. Richard Bain Smith is better than he was last September. He's more confident. He understands the world a little more. And he's beginning to see where he fits in. UC Riverside is better too. It's more confident that it can and will continue to change to match the times, to better serve the needs of its students and its community. These changes did not produce the high drama of violent confrontations, but the benefits for both students and the university are far more genuine and much longer lasting.